Okay, good morning. So maybe let me remind you where we stopped. So last time I started linking islands, right? So the first lecture was about isolated superconducting island. Second was about how to link them, how to describe the links between the islands. And we start with phenomenology, just introduce Josephson tunneling as a low energy theory, just with some adjustable parameters. And then started moving towards microscopic theory. And the idea was that we will write a Hamiltonian for tunneling of electrons, not pairs, not quasi-particles, but electrons. And then we will calculate two things. One, we'll calculate conductance in the normal state, which is a measurable quantity. And we gloriously accomplished that goal and came up with an expression for the conductance of a normal state junction, which we wrote in the following way: 8 pi e squared over h bar, 1 over the level space, product of level spacings in the leads, times matrix element of tunneling squared. You don't have to do it, but it's a good idea to check from time to time, kind of a sanity check, whether the expressions make sense in terms of scaling. So we talk about a junction, right? It has so many microns, say, in diameter and thickness. And the leads are huge, right? So the volume of leads doesn't enter, should not enter. This thing, delta epsilon, is scaling as 1 over volume, right? So this factor scales as volume of left lead times the volume of right lead. Is it bad? No, it's okay, because this matrix element, it comes from the probability of an electron to be close to the junction, right? So this TNL is psi, the wave function, at the left side of the junction. It's called R left squared times psi at the right side of the junction. Let's call it RR squared, right? And that, by normalization, scales as 1 over volume left and 1 over volume right. So this 1 over volumes will cancel volume here, and everything is fine. So this whole thing has the right scaling with the volume, OK? So again, you do it automatically. This product will cancel anyway from the final results, but it's nice to know that you're on the right track. So that's what we established. And another thing that we found is that irrespective whether we are considering a normal or superconducting state, we can write the free energy of the junction biased by phase. So once again, no superconductivity, but you can make a gauge transformation. You can gauge the wave functions assigning the phase e to I phi left and e to minus I phi right, and e to I phi right, sorry, to the wave functions. The tunneling matrix element will acquire a phase. This will create the dependence of the free energy on phase. Well, in principle, may create. The free energy is minus T log trace e to minus beta H, which is function of phi. And what we found that we can write current, which is average of quantum mechanical current over statistical distribution over Gibbs, is 2e d phi of f. And once again, this is an exact expression. It works also in normal metals. And in principle, it describes persistent currents, say in a ring, if you thread it with a flux. It's a tiny effect, and it's outside this course. We'll not discuss it. But in supersymmetric state, it gives an access to calculating the Joule current, and that's what we will use. It's one of many various ways to calculate Joule current, but I will pick this route. And moreover, we will look at low temperatures. So I will, instead of f of phi, which is free energy as a function of phi, I will just discuss the ground state energy, more specifically the part of the ground state energy that depends on phase. Okay, so that is our next step. Okay, so we will calculate the correction to the ground state energy coming from the fact that there is a junction and as a function of the phase difference between the electron wave functions in the leads. So we will do it perturbatively, but let's start with recalling what is the tunnel Hamiltonian. So in electron operators, it was T and L and R, matrix element, times the CNL dagger sigma, CNR sigma, plus conjugate. Now, if we are interested in superconductivity, it's convenient do the Bogoliubov transformation, because that will afford us having the leads Hamiltonians diagonalized, right? So the Hamiltonians of the leads then will be just written in the quasi-particle language as diagonal Hamiltonians. Now, but then we have to write what is this operator in quasi-particles. So, using Michel's suggestion, I will boldly put ups and downs instead of plus and minuses. Plus Vn gamma n down dagger and Cn down dagger equals minus Vn star gamma n up plus Un gamma n dagger down. So now we take this and plug in here, right? So if you just do it in your head, you'll see that by opening the parentheses, there will be two kinds of terms. There will be terms that transfer quasi-particles, so they'll have form gamma dagger gamma, and terms that create or annihilate pairs of quasi-particles, gamma dagger, or gamma gamma, right? So I can conveniently split HT on two parts. Let's call it HTQP for the part that scatters quasi-particles, and HTP for pairs. HTQP has products of UU factors, products, and VV factors, UNL, UNR star minus VNL, VNR star, gamma NL, gamma NR, and dagger is here, plus conjugate, and pair operator. Is sum over NL and R sigma. I can account for the plus or minus sign with sigma, which takes values plus 1 or minus 1. T and L and R, U and L, V and R, no star, plus V and L, U and R. Gamma n left dagger sigma, gamma n right dagger minus sigma. I'll put sigma bar. And here should be also sigma, sigma. Plus conjugate. So sorry, it's algebra, but I wanted to write it out. And I'll write one more boring line, but it will be useful. So we introduced you remember that we introduced phases in the very beginning of the first lecture to describe finite size systems. So, and once again, the phase can be picked in different ways. There are different gauges. It's convenient for me to now to pick the gauge where both U and V carry factors e to I phi over 2, but with opposite signs. You remember that what I used in the beginning was U is real and V has a factor e to minus I phi. I'll just split now this factor between U and V. Again, it does not enter into any final result, but it's convenient for intermediate formulas, this choice of gauge. Yes? Yeah, here, sigma takes values plus and minus 1. And it's pardon? Yes, yeah, right. Yeah, and that accounts simply for the difference between this and conjugate to this one. So far, so good. So let me work a little bit on this one. So with the choice of gauge that I just said, I can write U and L, U and R, star, e to I phi over 2, and all the phi say, again, for definiteness, are on the left lead, and I will not touch the right lead. So right lead has U's and V's are just real. Minus V and L V and R star e to minus I phi over 2. And for this one, V and L U and R equals absolute value e to I phi over 2 plus V and L U and R e to minus I phi over 2. Okay, one remark. You may remember the expressions for U and V. And probably I'll just write them. So there is a relation. And that comes simply from the necessity to keep the commutation relations between gammas to be fermionic, as well as it used to be for C's, right? So it's a canonical transformation. 1 half 1 minus psi n over epsilon n, and epsilon n is the quasi-particle spectrum. So from this relation, you can easily see that actually un vn entering into this term that creates or annihilates pairs is 1 half delta over epsilon n. You just write the product un vn, it's 1 minus psi over epsilon times 1 plus psi over epsilon, do algebra. So you see that actually this product is maximal at psi equals 0 and then it decays, right? So if I look at this product as a function of energy measured from the Fermi level, it is large in the strip of energy sort of delta and then it decays. So basically this the creation or annihilation of Cooper pairs due to the junction is effective for states close to the Fermi level. Okay. Okay, so that's important to know. So now, if we are after the ground state, after the ground state energy correction, well, first what we recall that how do we calculate correction to the energy? Perturbation theory, right? So the first order, we just take Hamiltonian and try to average it with unperturbed wave function. Unperturbed wave function is the ground state separately for left lead and right lead, right? So perturbation is tunneling. So without tunneling, you just have vacuum of quasiparticles for the left lead and vacuum for the quasiparticles on the right lead. Okay, so start with vacuum state. And then you try to average over the state Hamiltonian HT. What would you get? If you average HT, it's written here, over the product of ground states for the left and right lead. Zero. And there are at least two, I mean, okay, there are a number of reasons for it, but one is that it's off diagonal, right? So we cannot get a non-zero value just because the separators don't preserve the number of quasiparticles in either lead. Okay, now we go to the second order, and we think of conventional quantum mechanics. I know Landau-Lifshitz, it's the German section 3, paragraph whatever. And it's volume 3. Yeah, volume 3. You would find the following formula. I specified for the ground state. So ground state, you have your perturbation, which is in our case is HT. Sum over all other states, absolute value squared, divided by the energy difference between this state and this state. So we'll take this state as zero energy, and I'll just write E lambda. Okay, which will be the energy of what we call intermediate state, right? So it's wherever this HT can take you. So now, who can take me off from the ground state? If I look at this guy, it kills quasiparticle, okay, which doesn't exist. So acting with this part HTQP on ground state will give you just zero. So the only thing that remains is this one, because that acting on the ground state, which has no quasiparticle, just creates a pair, right? So this HT here can specify as HTP. And then you tell me what is E lambda. So for one term, let's look at one term. Okay, let's look at this two operators. And you tell me what is E lambda for one term that creates particles in state NL and NR. Any idea? Yes, yeah, you'll get A on final. Promise you. Okay. Right, so once again, that's because from vacuum we created a state NL and a state NR, which have energies, and maybe that actually shows that I wasn't pedagogical enough. So the unperturbed Hamiltonian, H left and H right, let me write a sum, is sum over NL sigma epsilon n gamma n sigma dagger gamma n sigma plus sum over NR sigma epsilon n gamma NR dagger gamma NR. Sigma, sigma, and L. Okay, so once again, so I started with vacuum and ended with two quasiparticles, that one in each lead, which have energies epsilon and L and epsilon and R. So, more line, so state lambda is gamma NL sigma dagger gamma NR sigma dagger acting on the ground state. Okay, so now I think I cannot be more explicit. After we figure this out, the rest is kind of cranking the handle. So I'll plug in here epsilon and L plus epsilon and R. Sum is over NL and R. So lambda is labeled by two indices. So let me erase this. Let me erase this. So I will not do just boring calculation, but let me just give you some pointers. So what do we do next? Again, we take this expression, okay? We square this factor. It's convenient to do using this form. Okay, so we are looking at this line. We square it. And there will be, you know, square of this guy, but also cross product, right? Which will give you phase dependence because of these two factors. So you'll get already, it's clear that you'll get phase dependence, some phase dependence. Now, another thing that you transform sum to an integral. So let me remind you that sum over, say, NL can be written as d xi over delta epsilon L. And I can do one more transformation, 1 over delta epsilon L. And I can write integral d xi as d energy, dE times d xi over d, which is just density of states. Okay, so this way I transform the integral to integral over d energy, and here's this normalization factor, right? So I will leave for homework just plugging in and doing this transformation. So it's homework, I think, number 5. You end up with the following expression, 1 over delta EL, delta ER, coming from a double summation. Integral d energy of left quasi-particles and right quasi-particles from delta, I'll write to infinity. I mean, integral is converging on upper limit, it's not a problem. Okay, the interesting part of integral is converging. This is coming from squaring of this line, all right? And again, you just do algebra, you'll get it. This is cross term that I mentioned. This come from just square of this guy and square of this guy. Then denominator. This sum is it stays as is, 1 over epsilon L plus epsilon R. The density of states, d xi d epsilon, gives you square root factors. That's basically I miss the main thing is T and L and R. T and L and R squared averaged over states at Fermi level. So once again, T squared comes from squaring of T. These guys come from going from sum to integral. And that's our favorite ratio, as you can see. There is some integral. And this expression actually is valid enough for a junction of two superconductors with different gaps. It still works. Yes?
Just a question about the expression derived for the perturbation theory. It seems you only consider state with one quasi particle on each item, and you remove all the states where we can have more than one particle on each superconducting item.
Yes, yeah, very good. Yes, that's the right question. So the thing is that I calculate correction to the ground state, right? So in ground state, I start with a state that doesn't have quasi-particles, okay? And then I look which states I can create by this Hamiltonian by acting with it on the ground state, right? And I intensely look at these two lines. And what I see is that this line will not produce, will just cancel out the state because it has annihilation operator. Okay, so you just annihilate state. Okay, so the only option is to use this line. Okay. And this line, out of vacuum, it creates one quasi-particle at the right and one at the left. And that's it, right? So you may, of course, you may try other states as well. And you'll get zero because the states will be disconnected from the ground state in terms of this Hamiltonian.
Yes.
Okay? Is it clear? Okay.
So the the product state, everything's paired on the left, everything's paired on the right, the ground
yes.
state, and then
yes,
the only thing that can tunnel is a real electron.
No, actually, this is a virtual, right? So this is
an electron, not inside the barrier, there's an electron.
Right. Right. So basically, you create two quasi-particles, meaning that you break a pair.
But then it's still a little surprising that there's a phase dependence, because you might think the other half of the matrix element just tunnels the electrons back, and the phase cancels. But that's not true.
You can tunnel electron back. But you kind of can tunnel electron forward as well.
Right, but that's the point.
Right.
That second term.
Right, so.
There's an electron tunneling in the same direction both times.
Yes, so we will get to this. I wanted to save this for future, but okay, that's good.
Sorry.
So, no, that's fine. Yes, good. It's a good point as well. So basically, we may recall that this gammas, I wrote C in terms of gammas, but I can also write gammas in terms of C, right? I can invert this. And then what I will see is that this gamma dagger will have terms of two types. One type is that I transfer an electron from one side to another, and that would be in these terms. But this guy corresponds to transferring actually one electron and then another electron. And these terms that correspond to transferring of a pair do lead to this phase-dependent part. So we will see it on some other quantity very explicitly. So if you don't like it now, which you may, I hope that you enjoy it next time in a few minutes. So one more remark. So I put here infinity after some hesitation. So kind of fine print, the disclosure is that actually this term, which is interesting, behaves nicely and converging. Now, this term, actually, if you look at it, it gives a divergent integral. And but don't despair. The thing is that I was lazy, and I calculated the correction to the ground state energy in superconducting state. What one needs to do really is to calculate the correction in superconducting state minus a correction in the normal state. Okay, because this tunnel Hamiltonian actually does shift all the states. And if you do it carefully, you should calculate the difference of energies between the two states. It's like when you calculate the energy gain at the transition, at the BCS transition. And this difference behaves nicely, and this term becomes regularized, so it doesn't diverge. But we are after the cos phi, so I will just disregard this one. Basically the last line before homework six would be that I'll set delta L equals delta R. The ground state energy correction, the phase dependent part, let me put here, of phi, can be written as minus 4, just the coefficient, TNL and R squared over delta epsilon L delta epsilon R and cos phi delta cos phi. So this is maybe I'll put here delta without absolute values, just defining delta as absolute value. And then some integral over dimensionless variables, dx dy from 1 to infinity of 1 over square root x squared minus 1, 1 over y squared minus 1, 1 over x plus y. Probably nowadays you just can plug it into Mathematica and find the answer. But yeah, but also can do it by hand. It was done like 50 years ago. Okay.
You'll get a master's student to solve that thing.
Undergrad student. He or she will use Mathematica. Right. Anyway, so that's basically it. So this is some number, and this factor is Gn up to the unit of conductance. So this way, we actually established a relation between the Joule's energy and conductance. And let me write it. Delta E ground state as a function of phase is minus EJ cos phi, according to our phenomenological definition. EJ that we derive this way is Gn divided by quantum unit of conductance E squared over H times also 1/8 times delta. This relation can be viewed as a form of Amberger-Karbarata formula. So that formula is for relation between the conductance and Joule's current rather than energy. But we have this expression, and we can write also current. EJ phi is minus, well, it's EJ. Just a second. To E EJ sine phi. I think I'm missing H bar. Right? So that's basically the end of this derivation of the non-dissipative current. Okay, so if we dial a phase across a junction, current will flow. Ij is proportional to sine phi, and the coefficient is proportional to Gn. Probably many of you heard about ICRN product as a figure of merit for the quality of the junction. So you can view this relation also as ICRN product. Okay, so G is 1 over R, so and this is basically a critical current. So it's ICRN equals to some constant. All right, so now we can proceed and look at it's beaten path still, but less beaten path. Look at the dissipative part of the AC admittance of Joule's junction. Okay, so if you like section titles, basically what we covered before was the Joule's effect. And the next part, so can I erase this board? Did you take a picture? Okay. real part of AC admittance. Of a junction. So last time, if you remember how we calculated normal conductance, we transformed the bias applied to the junction into the time dependence of the tunneling matrix element. Okay, and then we just used Fermi's golden rule. Okay. And somebody remarked that actually that should work also if I apply not constant bias, but AC bias. And that's exactly what I'm going to do. So if you look back at your notes, you'll find that we had phases introduced, phi L and phi R, in the form of a constant plus integral. And before I had V with a constant, and as a result, phase was just winding up and up and up and up, and this term was proportional to time. So now instead, thanks. So now let's look at V of t. Which is some amplitude V times cosine omega t. Okay, so the idea would be to take alternating voltage. Okay, but looking at small voltages. Okay, so I will plug it in here, do integral, and then these guys we are in exponents, e to I phi left, e to I phi right, and I will expand the exponent in small v. Okay. Because I want to look at linear response. Admittance corresponds to linear response. Okay, so if I do that, so integral is trivial, right? So it's V over omega sine omega t with minus sign, and respectively phi left of t minus phi right of t is E over H bar V sine omega t over omega, and HT, Hamiltonian HT. So once again, what I should do, I take this HT, okay? That's why I didn't want to raise it. I replace this phi over 2 by this guy, phi left minus phi right. You remember that this where phi, this curly proper phi, is twice this phi, which is defined per electron, and this phi was per pair, right? So phi over 2, var phi over 2 is phi around phi. So then basically, if I replace these phis by the modified expression, okay, I'll get HT, which depends on this modified phase. And then because V is small, I'll just expand in V. HT would be HT of phi as defined there, at given phase difference at the junction. Okay, so I can dial some phase difference and keep it. On top of that, I apply small AC. Are you with me? Maybe not. So imagine that you have a junction and you thread a flux through a loop. Okay, so this flux will fix the phase difference across the junction. This is my phi. And then I put some waveguide that shines RF or microwaves on this thing, okay? And because it's all metal, all the bias falls on the junction because it's the only one weak spot. So you apply basically bias across the junction, which in terms of phase would be additional V over omega minus sine omega t. Okay. And this is small. Okay, this is something fixed, and this is small. And I just expand Taylor series first term in this smallness, in this small parameter, ht. That's better, it's an operator, but it's still I can expand, right? So the first term will be ht of phi. That's ht at no bias. And the next term will be dd phi, ht of phi, times this additional phase, times minus 1 v over omega e over h bar sine omega t. Okay, so I expanded operator ht in small bias. Right? So basically, this is the most abstract thing that I will tell about. And if you can grasp that, then the rest is piece of cake. So let's reflect. We had a perturbation, ht. Before applying a bias, it did depend on phase, okay? And we found some DC, non-dissipative Joson current, okay? Now we perturb it. And the operator ht acquired this additional part, dd phi ht times time-dependent part. Okay. Now I want to do play the old trick. I want to find power dissipated by the junction because it's subject to AC perturbation. Okay. And I want to do it in the lowest order. I want to do it in the lowest order in V and in tunneling. Lowest order in V, well, power must be proportional to V squared, right? It cannot be linear in V. Power is absorbed. If you're getting power that is emitted from the junction, that something is wrong. So so V squared is the lowest power, and it would correspond to square of this parameter. And HT is proportional to the matrix element T, and we wanted square too. So basically, if I do just the Fermi-Golden rule with respect to this term, I'll be done. So the next thing that I'll do is the following. I'll just take this operator. Okay, I know the operator form. I know everything about it. Find its matrix elements, square, multiply by delta functions that corresponds to energy conservation, occupation factors beginning at the end, and absorbed photon energy, which is h bar omega in this case. And it'll be done, right? So it's the same schema that we had before for normal junction, but applied for this Hamiltonian, which is dd phi h times the perturbation. Before doing this, I would like also to suggest yet another homework, which, I mean, it's nice in a number of respects. Rederive gn this way. So it's not obvious actually that you'll get the same formula, but you will. And the reason why it's not obvious is that basically we're talking about two different limits. The calculations that I did before for GN was that frequency was zero, okay? And then I took some bias. And if I look at a small bias, okay, I'll find GN at V to zero. So the order of limits is omega goes to zero first and then voltage goes to zero, okay? Here, we are manifestly in opposite regime. if you look here, V over omega, it's clear that it's a bad idea to take omega to zero first, right? You have to take V to zero first, and then omega to zero. And limits may not commute. So it happens so that they do give the same result for normal conductance. And that's basically because conductance at low frequencies for normal junction is not, well, it's weakly dependent on frequency. Now, with a junction in a superconducting state, that is very much not true. Well, just from the common grounds, you know, if you take the formula that we will get for admittance, it may depend on phase, Okay, so I take this formula, I take omega to zero, I'll get results that depends on phase, right? So which phase should I put? If I then design another experiment, break the circuit, okay, and just apply a battery, there'll be still a current. I mean, it's after all, it's Guevara or no, some sub-gap currents that are measured. So how this conductance will be related to the admittance? It's an interesting question. It's answered. I'll give you a reference if you want. But once again, you know, seeing that the two limits, omega to zero and v to zero, give the same result, is kind of heartwarming, or maybe disappointing, depending on the system. Okay, after these lyrics, let's get our hands somewhat dirty. So maybe let me I want to keep this. I'll erase maybe this part. Plus minus E over H bar V over omega sine omega t. So now let's maybe do a little bit more of observations. So imagine that I did what I'm saying, that I plugged in this phase, expanded, I got this Hamiltonian, okay? I will look at first at this part, HTP, okay? So the operator structure is gamma dagger, gamma dagger, okay? It creates a pair. This term, if I differentiate over the phase, the operator structure doesn't change, right? These factors will change, but the operator structure is the same. So this guy out of HTP will create a term which has form gamma dagger, times sine omega t, okay? So you have a source that creates pairs of quasi-particles, okay? I have a question. What is the minimal frequency for which I will have absorption, for which I will be able to create quasi-particles? 2 delta, right? Because I have to exchange H bar omega to two energies, epsilon and L, epsilon and R, and minimal energy is delta and delta, okay? So this term out of this formula will produce the high frequency absorption at H bar omega larger than 2 delta. Let's not bother with that, and let's concentrate on low energies. So then we have to sweat through this term, okay, and disregard this one. So actually, it's not much of a sweat. So this part of HT, which is a perturbation, the perturbation, I will call it delta H of T, it has, so it's minus 2 E V over H bar omega sine omega t times defy H tunneling QP of phi. I'm sorry, I missed here too, because d defy, so this curly phi is different from this phi, and I'm sorry, but should be 2 here. And I can write it as HAC times e to I omega t minus e to minus I omega t with HAC being EV over 2 H bar omega times sine over NL and R. Sigma just comes from this stuff. TNL, TNR, UNL, UNR star plus VNL, VNR star. Gamma N left dagger, gamma N right without dagger, minus complex conjugate. So you can notice a change of sign, and it came from taking the derivative and the fact that these phi's are of opposite sign. So that's basically that's it. So then it's mechanics that I will skip. This is matrix element. This is the operator that transfers a quasi particle from one lid to another. And the factor here, gives you oscillatory factors, which are either corresponding to absorption or emission of a photon. And just take this formula, these matrix elements, plug into the expression for the power, which we discussed in the context of normal junction. And you'll find HAC delta E lambda minus E eta minus omega minus delta E lambda minus E eta plus omega and H bar. So this double angular brackets correspond to two averagings. That's why it's double. So one is quantum mechanics, another one is statistics. So what do we do? We take a state, okay, and write matrix elements to all possible final states. So we sum over the final states, then we average over the initial states. So we average with the distribution functions of quasi-particles, right? So for each particular state, quasi-particle state at the beginning, we just sum over all outcomes. And then we average over the initial states. So that's these double brackets. And my point is that we don't have to be in thermal equilibrium. So we will express answer in terms of the distribution functions of quasi-particles, whatever they are, okay? So I didn't assume at any point Gibbs. So once again, from here to the final formula, it's just a set of very standard moves. So I will skip them. It's somewhat boring, and write an answer. So the real part of the admittance of Josephson junction at frequency omega and phase phi, right? So you remember this little drawing I had with a loop. So phi is dialed by, say, by flux, and omega is the frequency of microwaves that shine on it, shine on the junction. Equals Gn over 4 h bar omega. Maybe let's don't need 4 here. H bar omega integral d epsilon from delta to infinity. I have to erase. Square root epsilon plus omega squared minus delta squared and epsilon squared minus delta squared. And that's it.
sorry. I forgot the most important part. F of epsilon times F of epsilon plus omega minus F of epsilon plus omega 1 minus F of epsilon. Okay, so now I'm done.
So once again, so technical things. There's summation over NL and NR here, okay? But there is a delta function that takes out one summation. So that's why at the end there is single integral. Again, sum to integrals, I already explained it a couple of times how we do it. This comes from the densities of states, initial and final states. And numerator comes from matrix elements, from this U's and V's. And once again, because you square something that actually depends on phases, there is this term, which is phi dependent. So Steve already took out the nice explanation, but I will repeat it. So why there is this term there? So basically, if you look at the barrier, you transfer an electron. Barrier is insulator. The barrier does know about quasi particles. It doesn't exist there. Okay, so barrier admits and passes or reflects electrons, right? And there are two ways to transfer an electron. One way is to take a quasi particle which pretends to be an electron and shove it into the other lid, right? So it's left to right, and I transferred an electron. There is another route. Okay, I do the following thing. I can take an electron from here, so quasi particle that pretends to be a hole, and move it back, right? At the same time, I take a Cooper pair, which is 2e, and move forward. So this process transfers also one electron from left to right. Okay, you end up with a state which is indistinguishable from this one. So there are two amplitudes that you have to sum. And one of them involves Cooper pair, so it does know about the phase difference of the condensates. So that's basically the origin of this phase dependence here. Yes, and yes, thank you. Yes, rushing. Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, yeah. Probably there are more mistakes. Yes, yeah, so and occupation factors come from simply, you know, I have to start with occupied state and end in empty state. So that's the origin of this guy, and this is just inverse process. It's from down to up, and this is from up to down. Because I have a classical source, so it's not photons, just you can count one by one, it's just AC classical field, plenty of photons. So they take you up or down with the same efficiency. So that's basically the general expression. And again, we obtained it, in my view, in the simplest way, just looking at the absorption power. You can, in principle, do linear response, and this is doable and educational, but it's harder for a physical reason. So the thing is that the dissipative term is perturbative in the sense that the dissipative current is linear in applied bias, right? Now, the non-dissipative, actually, for Josephson junction is very non-perturbative because there is AC Josephson effect, okay? So if you apply finite bias to a junction, you have current which is sine VT. So, and if you do just Cooper formula, you have to deal with both parts, and that is a bit harder, okay? So we kind of cut the corner a bit by disrespecting the AC Josephson effect, the non-dissipative part. Okay, maybe one formula that I need for future. If the effective temperature of quasi-particles is low compared to to the microwave frequency, and in turn, omega is much less, well, h bar, omega is much less than delta, then basically only low energies, epsilons close to delta matter. And in this case, actually, this interference is most manifesting, okay, because basically this boils down to delta times delta, so it's delta squared plus delta squared cos phi. And it just goes to zero when phi equals pi. So to be precise, I can write rho y in this limit as 1 plus cos phi over 2 times rho y, I will call it qp of omega. And this rho y qp of omega can be written in the following form. 1/2 normal conductance to delta over h bar omega power 1/2 xqp. And xqp is defined the way I defined it a while ago, if you remember. In these notations, it's square root pi integral dx over square root x f of delta times 1 plus x. This is dimensionless. Everything is dimensionless. But basically, that's the same definition that I had before. So as you see, it's pretty amazing that if you create a phase phi equals pi across a junction, then you should have the minimal, actually zero, according to this relation, dissipative part of admittance. So now finally, in the last 25 minutes of the three lecture course, I'll come to the essence of the promised material. So I'll tell how the quasi-particles interact with the qubit. It's remarkably simple. Basically, the key is this line. So look what we did so far. We told ourselves that we fixed some phase across a junction. And then the tunnel Hamiltonian for quasi-particles describes tunneling with amplitude that depends on the phase of the junction, right? So we fix the phase. Who are we, after all? Can we fix the phase? So the thing is that if we have a qubit, then the phase has its own life. It's described by a Hamiltonian, which we called H phi in the beginning. It's a qubit Hamiltonian. And for all practical purposes, the dynamics of the phase phi is relatively slow compared to delta, well, delta over h bar. So we can endow this phase by a hat and make it an operator that is a variable, a quantum variable, in a Hamiltonian that describes qubit. So basically, I think this is a part three and the last part of what I'll be able to cover. Qubit transitions driven by quasi-particles and through one is a qubit interaction with quasi-particles. So the Hamiltonian consists now of three parts. The qubit part, which we had last time, right? So charging energy, dd phi squared plus cos, well, minus cos phi, maybe minus phi, well, plus phi squared out of inductance. Hamiltonian of quasi-particles in the leads, okay? And these two parts just live separately and they don't know about each other, they don't bother each other. So in principle, if quasi-particles would not tunnel, nothing bad happens to the dynamics of the qubit because this is just two separate Hilbert space. All the troubles come from HTQP, which is a function, becomes a function of phi. So this HTQP is a function of phi. I can write again a sum, NL, TNL and R, UNL, UNR star E to I phi hat over 2 minus VNL VNR star E to minus I phi over 2 gamma NL dagger gamma NR without a dagger plus conjugate. So this is only part that matters. This part, the pair part, for this discussion is not important. It's benign because this corresponds to creation and annihilation quasi-particles, which will take you energy to delta, okay? Qubit doesn't have this energy. The qubit excitations are much, energies are much lower than two delta. So this term doesn't matter. As long as there are no external photons, you can forget about it. And the interaction of the qubit degrees of freedom, degree of freedom with the quasi-particles is basically in this term. I would like to emphasize that it's a nonlinear interaction. The matrix element depends not on phi linearly, not on phi dot linearly, but e to I phi. Physically, it's a very simple thing. If you remember, operator e to I phi over 2 boosts half of a Cooper pair. E to I phi boosts a pair, so e to I phi over 2 just boosts half of a Cooper, which is electron. So these two guys just count the number of electrons that tunneled. Okay, so now having this Hamiltonian, the rest is just repeating the story that we had already. Fermi-Golden rule. This Hamiltonian is capable of transferring a quasi-particle from lead to another lead and simultaneously doing something to qubit due to these two operators. So we take initial state as a product state of the quasi-particle wave function times the qubit wave function. Okay, and then we take this state, we apply this operator, and we go, as a result, we come to another state where both the qubit wave function and quasi-particle function can change, right? And this guy, for example, can be corresponding to upper level of the qubit and go to the lower level at the expense of creating quasi-particles. Oh, sorry, of boosting the energy of quasi-particles, not creating. So once again, the calculation is very similar to what we did before, so I will not repeat it. And there is a reference in notes. The result. So the rate of transitions between two states, initial and final, I and F, can be written in the following fairly compact form. So you see here, instead of this difference, we have only f times 1 minus f because we're talking about quantum system. So a qubit is excited or in ground state, and when transition happened, it happened, right? So we have no the counter term like here because of the infinite supply of photons. times. So these vectors are very similar to the upper line. That's why I didn't want to erase it. And here comes interesting thing. So so instead of the phase dependence, what we are having are matrix elements of this e to I phis and e to I minus I phis. And it's what you can do if you square this line. It's better to form cosine and sine out of this, because basically you can check easily that cosines and sines live separately, and the cross term upon integration over energies vanishes. So there is a matrix element of sine phi over 2, and a matrix element for cos phi. Minus delta squared okay.
That's operator phi,
yes, yeah. So maybe let's do this. So so again, notations I and f are qubit states. So these are some size of phi, right? And having h phi, you can just numerically calculate all the matrix elements, and this is done very efficiently. Once again, it's matrix elements not of phi or phi dot. It's some nonlinear functions. And you can see that there is pretty significant correspondence between the two expressions. Now, again, skipping lots of details, I would say that generically, this first term is more important at low temperatures because of the numerator here. There is plus sign rather than minus sign, and it survives at low energies. And that allows one to establish a quite nice relation between the energy relaxation of a qubit, so gamma 1 0 and re y. This is a classical thing, right? So nothing quantum about phase here. Now gamma 1 0 at low temperatures can be written as matrix element times, I hope I do the coefficients right, omega over pi 1 over e squared over h times real part of y qp of omega. And I will probably okay, so so maybe let me erase this extra line and concentrate on this sequence of relations. So what did we do? So in these boxes are the response of a junction to the classical microwave field, right? And at low temperatures, real part of the admittance is proportional to 1 plus cos phi, where the phi is a phase across the junction that is fixed, say, by external magnetic field. Now, this is the relation for the rate of relaxation of a qubit from state 1 to state 0 under the same conditions, meaning low effective temperature and the transition frequency omega if is small compared to delta. And there is a pretty close correspondence, okay? So this factor is the same, and the phase dependence here is replaced by matrix element of the phase for a qubit.
So can we evaluate this matrix element? What's in the bracket?
Yes, yes, we can. Yes, yeah. Yes, we can, and actually it was done. So so first of all, maybe to demystify. So what does this calculation amounts to? You have, I can erase this now. You have the qubit Hamiltonian, which is 1 over I dd phi minus ng squared plus minus Ej cos phi plus El some coefficient phi minus phi over phi naught squared. Okay, you can just and boundary conditions, right? So you can find psi I of phi and psi f of phi for any state. Okay, so in particular psi zero and psi one. And then this matrix element is just, you know, it's as simple as d phi psi zero phi star sine phi over two psi one of phi. So there is no any mystery. It's just so now time is short. So let me maybe do the following. Yes, thank you. That's another good remark. 0101. Yeah. Okay, so we have another 15 minutes, a bit less. So one thing is that is it possible somehow to benefit from this relation? So actually, I should make a small remark. So I didn't know what is cos phi problem. I've heard it first about this name from Michelle, but then I downloaded, I bootlegged some text. Joseph, 1962, seminal paper. The current, the Joseph current, phenomenologically was written in the form ij of t temperature sine phi plus v sigma of t times 1 plus epsilon of t cos phi. Okay, and the remark that that phi actually is phi of t, which is 2 ev t over h bar plus phi naught. So by symmetry, just understanding, okay, there is a non-dissipative current and there is some dissipative current. So I mean, again, experimentally probably not the best way to approach the problem because this thing is time dependent. And the next thing, of course, one can try to do is to look at the at what we basically do, okay, at AC perturbation around fixed phi zero. So basically, take small v, expand in small v, and look at the response at small v. And turns out that that was done in, well, people tried to do it in mid 70s. I mean, there was no successful experiment. And basically, what was figured out recently is that basically this allows you to translate the problem of measuring of tiny real admittance on the background of huge non-dissipative part, which comes from Joseph current. You translate this question into the measurement of the time, relaxation time. So it's in time domain. And that is possible to do. You have to just to pick the right qubit. And the right one is basically as a qubit which is close to the classical classical junction, meaning that the these two terms are large compared to charging energy, and the qubit oscillations, the phase oscillations, are around a minimum that is found by minimizing this form. So Ej sine phi 0 plus El phi 0 minus, well, 2 pi phi external over phi 0 equals 0. Okay, so basically this is finding the extremum, and around the extremum there will be basically classical oscillations. It's harmonic oscillator. If you're at Yale, you have to deal with harmonic oscillators. This frequency omega 1 0 square root 8 EC, well, EJ plus some number, actually EL plus EJ cos phi naught. So it's an oscillator, so you locally have basically a parabolic potential and levels, and then you look at this transition. Unfortunately, this transition is allowed because sine phi, phi over 2 is odd function. And this transition is between the even and odd state, so odd and even state, so that's allowed. The only thing that I have to expand sine phi over 2 around phi 0, right? So it will be sine phi 0 over 2, sorry, cos phi 0 of 2. Times 1/2 d phi plus 0 to, yeah, that's it, sorry. So this is basically delta phi and energy, and then matrix element exists between 1 and 0, and so the transition is possible. But the amplitude is proportional to cos phi, over, cos phi 0 over 2, right? So, and it comes in square, so you get cos squared phi 0 over 2, which is exactly the same. So basically, for quasi-classical qubit, if you dial a phase across a junction, you will be able to see the dependence of gamma on the external phase, which will be the same as this one, as the Re Yj for classical junction. So maybe let me do the, so one more remark and then I'll show some experimental data and will not infringe too much on the coffee break. I kept NG here on purpose. So what is gate voltage? Basically, if you think of the following circuit, there is a junction between two islands, okay? And NG is a relative potential bias between the leads. So you can imagine that you have some battery, okay? And you bias the junction by NG, right? Now, imagine that a quasi-particle tunneled from one lead to another, right? What does it mean from the point of view of condensate? If you're in a condensate, what you see is that you change charge by 1e. So it's a jump of NG, right? So the point is that the quasi-particle transitions are associated with the jumps of NG, E jumps, we call it E jumps, right? And if you have, say, a lousy transmon, so transmon doesn't have this, okay, and a lousy transmon has small Ej over Ec. So then when Ng jumps by one, the level jumps. The ground state level jumps and the excited level jumps. So basically, there are four levels, odd, even, say, even, odd charges, and transitions, quasi-particle transitions, actually I think that I did it, yeah, right. Quasi-particle transition actually take you from even to odd, or from odd to even. You also have transitions of this type, but not between even and even. So if you are able to resolve these levels in a lousy qubit, you can pinpoint the transitions associated with the quasi-particle tunneling. Okay, that was done. So I would like to basically to use last 5 minutes just to show some experimental data. So maybe let's try to hook up.
It's HDMI. I decided to sleep, I think.
Okay, so now we'll see whether it works. So she didn't pass the signal, so somehow doesn't want to. Is it wrong wire? Okay. Voila. Okay. So maybe. Let's. I can even use. All right. So. So that's what I try to. Oops. Right, so this is just what I try to explain. So this is a classical formula. This is the counterpart for the qubit relaxation. Okay, so then the experiment goes like this. So. It's with fluxonium, and you can dial the phase across the junction close to half-life quantum. So you take phi external or phi zero close to 1/2. Okay, so now the price for having a qubit and calculating this matrix element that we just asked about, okay, is this factor which depends in all glory details on EJ over EC and EJ over EL. So that ideally would be 1, but it's not 1 because you have some more complicated wave functions. But your eyes should be locked to this part. And the strategy is to measure 1 over T1 and then look at the phase dependence. Then try to cast the result into this form with some epsilon. Okay, and you wish epsilon would be 1, right? Then there is no this part, and this is just gives you this one. And you try to put error bars on epsilon. And here's a device. It's Jan Popp's, I think, creation. The data. So basically, you can look here, and you can ask Jan about the spread. But the thing is that if you follow kind of the dense accumulation of points, 1 over T1 indeed follows quite well this quadratic dependence. And the best fit is epsilon is like 0.9. Well, point in some number of nines. You see, 0.991 is already here, and 0.999 is here. So, so it looks like it's a pretty decent confirmation of this cos phi effect. I think on the physics side, which maybe you know, on the informative side, I would say, is that you can also extract what is XQP, what is the density of quasi-particles, and indeed, it's in the ballpark of 10 to minus 6. It's about 8 to 32 times 10 to minus 7. Okay, so that's this is a real outcome of this experiment. So that's about the classical limit of the quasi-particle transitions in a fluxonium, and that's what I also try to wave my hands about. This is the resolved measurement that in a lousy transmon that allows to see to associate transitions with E jumps, with parity jumps. So because you have an access to frequency and E jump does change the frequency, there is a way to see transitions which are energy relaxations. So between the level one and level zero, well, manifold one and manifold zero, these kinds, but also transitions within manifold one, when and even within manifold zero, as far as I remember. So these transitions give you the rates of each jumps with different outcomes, de-energizing the qubit or just changing the charge state without changing the computational state, if you want. So that's, I didn't talk about at all, but maybe, yeah, I still have, well, I have minus 2 minutes, so let's make it minus five. You see, you can go from up to down and from down to up. Now, if you have just equilibrium quasi-particles at lower temperatures, there is little balance. So it's easy to do this, but it's very hard to do this. Okay, you don't have energy in quasi-particles to give this jump. Now, what was found in the experiment actually was a bit disconcerting because this ratio for this particular experiment was close to one, unlike the prediction. Then there is a more fine detail, so I thought that I'll not run out of time that badly. I kept these two terms, and I was telling that in majority of cases this term is more important because of this factor. But the transitions of this type, actually, because of the oddity of this function, this term is not relevant, but this one is relevant. And if you take into account all the details, actually it turns out that the ratio of the state conserving transitions, so between even and odd, say within one, so one gamma 1 to 1 or gamma 0 to 0, divided by the relaxation rate, actually is small. Okay, it's a fight between the moderately large and very small parameter, and the result is small. Now, an experiment was manifestly not true, so it was 4. And basically, the resolution of this paradox is that there are stray photons. So if a photon with energy larger than 2 delta comes in, then it requires me to redo the work and to consider terms HTP, not HTQP, but HTP pairs, okay? And consider a process in which a photon comes in, breaks a Cooper pair, okay? Now the thing is that the photon, if the wavelength of the photon is of the size of the qubit or larger, then all the voltage of the photon drops on the junction. So basically, if the photon is absorbed, I know where it's absorbed. Okay, and if it's absorbed in the junction, I know what happens. It breaks a Cooper pair and takes one electron across the junction. So the photons are brutally effective in creating the transitions where quasi-particle tunnels. Way more effective than ambient quasi-particles. Basically this effect, if you do the calculation again, can explain this ratio. So here are some tries to fit, and basically you find indeed that gamma down and gamma up are order of one relation ratio, and gamma 0,0 to gamma 1,1 also fits this factor of 4 quite well. If you assume that there are photons with energy about 2.8 delta, so somewhat larger than 2 delta. Now, it turns out that, you know, you have to have like 10 to minus 2 photons in the cavity to have the, to explain the data. So it's quite rare events of getting a photon, of bad photon into a cavity, but this bad photon is really bad. Okay, so I think I'm done. I'll just flash maybe two slides. So I talked about the effect of quasi-particles, and we finally got to the discussion how they create the transitions of the qubit. Now, how to mitigate? Well, I mean, the experiments that are done so far are just of the following type. You flood your system with quasi-particles, okay, and try to see what kind of modifications of the design would evacuate quasi-particles as soon as possible. Right. So again, I emphasize that experiments about suppressing the ambient number of quasi-particles are ongoing. I think we don't know really how things will work out. But the question that is answered is that how to capture quasi-particles that are injected in the qubit. And the two things that were studied quite well, I mean, one is, I think, is beautiful, although maybe practicality is finite or limited. So a vortex is a local suppression of the gap. It can trap a quasi-particle. And you can, with qubits, it's impossible, it was not done ever before. You can really see how the trapping power of the system of vortexes goes stepwise when you increase the number of vortexes. So you basically can find the trapping power of a single vortex, and by increasing magnetic field, you can see how the trapping rate goes up with the number of vortexes. And on a more practical note, you can also try to put normal traps. And there are some experiments that did show how the quasi-particles are basically trapped by normal inclusions. Again, there is a number of works in progress, but what we know by now actually is that the trapping actually is temperature dependent, and there is some quite cute mechanism for that beyond these lectures, but will be in the notes. There are some sequence of experiments, and our level of understanding is sufficient to collapse data of different experiments on some curve, which we also can read in the notes. So I think that's all, and I'm happy to take questions. Questions. Does it affect? Yeah. Yes, they are. But thank you for the question. So vertices are dangerous things. This is definitely a true statement. They also probably is hard to avoid. Now the thing is that they work in two ways. So the way that I have shown is very cute, but it's quite delicate. The thing is that electric field moves the vortex, and when it's moving, it creates dissipation. So if you keep increasing field, so if you have, say, three vertices far away from the junction, it's wonderful, okay? If you have three vertices close to the junction, it's deadly, because just the motion of vertices will degrade the Q factor. So what happens actually is that due to the geometry, so I would say this, typical geometry is here, okay? So there are some skinny lines, okay? And then it's antenna, right? So there are some pads. So when you put magnetic field, the first place vertices come are here. So they are very far from the junction, and there are small electric fields here. So these are good, you know, particles diffuse and get trapped here. If you increase field, eventually, the vertices penetrate into the skinny parts, or rather in capacitor, and are sitting close to the junction. And this is the kiss of death. I mean, that's but so I'm not sure that I have the curve. Yeah, you see it's cut here, but and I because it's lectures I didn't. So if you continue increasing the field, actually, and look at 1/tau, it's something bad happens. I mean, goes down there. Yeah. Say it again?
So in the next slide,
yeah.
These normal metal taps are to keep the vortex from moving.
No. So basically, the vortex, let's forget about traps for a second. My point was that the larger the area, the easier for vortex to enter. So roughly speaking, there is a difference between field cooled and zero field cooled, then applying field. But apart from the differences, basically, rule of the thumb is the area allows flux quantum in a given field, there will be a vortex. Okay, so now the area of this thing and a square cut here. Okay, if I take the width of the line and make a square here, the areas are different. So as a result, when you apply field, these are vulnerable parts and these are less vulnerable. So you don't need any piece of metal in order to avoid vertices here. They'll be here anyway because this is big. Okay. Now the normal traps is different story. the normal traps are, in a sense, are better as a vortex, because normal trap is basically a part where you have no gap or very low gap, okay? And a quasi-particle, when it goes over this part where there is a no bottom, it falls, right? Again, you wish it falls, but it may just zoom over and not fall, and this is, I mean, the devil is in the details, so. Enter the details. Okay, more questions. Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.